Good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us tonight for service. It's Ash, in case you don't know. So I'm going to go on with our welcome, but I send all of y'all lots of hugs and loves. Bethel is an inclusive faith community seeking to transform lives by exemplifying the unconditional love of Jesus. We extend a cordial and heartfelt welcome to all who join us for worship today in person, via Zoom, or live stream. Thank you goodness for hybrid. Welcome to those new to the Christian faith, those who are longtime followers of Christ, as well as those who are just curious about the faith in Christ. To our friends who are without a church home and to those visiting with friends and family from another faith community, to those who need strength, want to follow Jesus, have doubts, or do not yet believe, to people of every color, culture, sexual orientation, gender identification, economic background, age, size, ability, and challenges, old friends and new guests, to the old and the young, believers and questioners and questioning believers, we welcome you to worship God with us on this day.
Okay, may the peace of our Lord be with each and every one of you.
And also with you.
Please join us in singing Act Justly. Down to this, what you require of me, to love my neighbor as myself, and you above all things. Act justly, love mercy, walk humbly.
You are here, working in this place.
Today's scripture reading is from 2 Corinthians 5. Therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we try to persuade others. But we ourselves are well known to God, and I hope that we are also well known to your consciences. We are not commending ourselves to you again, but giving you an opportunity to boast about us, so that you may be able to answer those who boast in outward appearance and not in the heart. For if we are beside ourselves, it is for God. If we are in our right mind, it is for you. For the love of Christ urges us on, because we are convinced that one has died for all, therefore all have died. And he died for all, so that those who live might live no longer for themselves, but for him who died and was raised for them. From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view. Even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view, we know him no longer in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. Here ends the reading.
I invite you to pray with me. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. This is part two of the message that I started last week on being agents of reconciliation. We live in a divided culture, making conversations about many topics really difficult. And as I consider the current condition in our society, I repeatedly ask myself this question that's raised by a quote by Verket Murthy. What can we do in our lives through the decisions that we make, the choices we make, to tip the scales in the world away from fear and hate towards courage and love? I'm going to repeat that because I just wanted to sit with you for a minute. What can we do? What can you do? What can I do in our lives through the decisions we make, the choices we make, to tip the scale in the world away from fear and hate towards courage and love? Amidst the division in the world, Bethel Encino Lutheran Church community has taken a bold stand to live into becoming a reconciling in Christ faith community, a community of love for all people. A few weeks ago, when we began the process to become an RIC congregation, someone asked me a very pointed question. Said, "Pastor, are all people really welcomed at Bethel? What about the racist? What about the bigot?" And I believe I speak not only as the pastor for our community and as one of the servant leaders, but as one of the disciples in Christ here at Bethel Lutheran Church when I say, all people are welcome, but all behaviors are not welcome. All people are welcome, but not all behaviors are welcome. So today we continue with part two of the message. And by way of recap, last time I said that in the creation account, Jesus, or God, says in Genesis chapter 1, humankind was created in the image of God. And scripture has God proclaiming that all of God's creation was good, therefore all humans, all of us have value. All of us warrant respect. Another point I made was that the creation story consists of four prominent relationships. And this is not my idea, something I read by one writer. And the writer said that the creation story consists of the spiritual domain. That's our relationship with God. And the creation story consists of the physical domain. That's our relationship with creation, with the earth, with the stars, with the moon, with the dirt and the animals, with creation. The creation story also consists of the mental domain. That's our relationship with ourself. And the creation story consists of the social domain. That's our relationship with each other. Scripture also suggests that God intended these relationships, all four of these relationships, to live harmoniously. But brokenness in human relationships have affected our connection with each other, our connection with God, our connection with the earth, and sometimes even our connection with ourselves. And this has produced many of the challenges that we currently face as individuals, as a people, as a nation, and as a world today. So Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, 18 to 20 points out that reconciliation is needed in order to harness, in order to bring those relationships back into right standing, in order to heal the brokenness that's involved in those relationships. And it involves restoring broken relationships, reconciliation. It involves healing the deepest wounds. It involves transforming hearts. In a recent issue of Sojourner magazine, any of you ever heard of that magazine, Sojourner magazine? Hannah Bowen writes this, and she says, "Every time political polarization comes up in the news cycle, my progressive Christian circle start discussing how should churches deal with the supposed epidemic of polarization and divisions across the nation." She continues to write, "In the face of deep disagreement within families and communities, what role does the church play in mediating differences? Churches often, she says, demonize polarization because of this disruptive nature that it has, and it can lead to conflict and upset the status quo. For example, before 2020, these are her words, racial justice upspring, some churches hesitated to say Black Lives Matter because some Christians believed it was a polarizing issue. I'm going to skip to another writer, then go back to how she finishes that statement. Another writer puts it this way. The problem is not just that the church members disagree on who to vote for. The problem is not that people get angry, shoot fiery emails to the pastor, and get into bursting fist fights in the parking lot or on Facebook. The problem is not even that some things are suddenly intensively political. However, they weren't before, trusting health experts saying everyone is created in the image of God. You know, it was okay when we weren't saying that or preaching on subjects of poverty. The problem of polarizations of churches struggling to minister is that people stop fighting. That's what this writer says, that people stop fighting. They part their ways. They sort themselves by preferences. Does unity in Jesus Christ only come after we are politically in agreement? Is partnership stronger than the gospel? Are partisanship stronger than the gospel? She goes on to say, avoiding clarity about justice because it seems divisive can cause misunderstandings about when or what it means to live in unity in the Christian faith, and raises the question whether preserving a model of loving unity by avoiding conflict is the only option. What if the process of being in battle is a way that we faithfully live out the Christian unity and move towards reconciliation? Just something to think about. I was in a conversation, and this is not part of my notes, but I was in a conversation with a group of people this week at a Bible study that I was leading. And the subject got on race issues for some reason. And, you know, the person went on to say, well, you know, Black people are always playing the race card. I'm like, what are you talking about? But what I appreciated about that conversation is that I knew I had a lot of skin in the game, pun intended. But I said, you know what? I'm gonna engage this person. I did not have the energy to become defensive. I did not have the energy to become upset. I said, I wanna hear your point of view. And I stayed in the conversation. I totally disagreed with everything they said. And I pointed that out, but I stayed there. I didn't go in my corner and say, you go in your corner. Reconciliation happens when we first come to terms with the alienation. It comes to terms with the alienation that we have experienced, and the distancing, the division, and dissension that we have caused. It's not just about what someone has done to me. What have I done to someone? That's a starting point for reconciliation. It's not just patching up the differences or making a private peace with what's wrong in the world or putting a bandage over hurts that we have endured or hurts that we have inflicted upon others. So Paul says, a step towards reconciliation begins when we hear, not just hear, believe, not just believe, but begin to act on the proclamation in scripture that God values, God accepts, God loves, God has mercy for and grace towards all of humanity. And then he says, there is a realignment that begins to happen. that really spills over into our social world, spills over into our family life, spills over into our business world, spills over even into our politics, and might even spill over into the church. And what is this realignment? It's a realignment of the heart. Realignment of the heart. It's a heart problem. It's a heart problem, Paul says. It's a heart matter. Have you ever heard the saying, it's a matter of the heart, or it's a heart matter? For Paul, reconciliation begins within a realignment of your heart and of my heart. That's a starting point for Paul. Ambassadors of reconciliation live and act out of this fundamental vision that the human race is interconnected. Interconnected. So our charge as ambassadors, of agents of reconciliation, is to ground in our conviction of the interdependence. Be grounded in that conviction of the interdependence. I need you, and whether you want to believe it or not, you need me. We're already one writer says, but we imagine that we're not. Thomas Merton said that. And so the continuation of the message, Paul in the text is talking about the reality of this oneness that we experience as human beings. And our challenge as agents of reconciliation is to recover what this unity, this oneness that we have as human beings is. Ambassadors of reconciliation help us to refocus on this unity, supporting the hope of many people who share this vision of a reconciled world. Can you envision a world where the lion lays down with the lamb? You know, where the Democrat and the Republican sit at the same table and not hate each other and not sling words? Where people of different races and different orientations can sit at the same table and enjoy their humanity together? Yeah. Unity supporting hope of the many who share this vision of reconciliation, this world. And that becomes our assignment. And that begins when we begin to face the split, the ruptures and the wounds that surround us, especially fractures connected with relationships, positions that separate, systems that oppress people. And reconcilers often work in these areas. And if we want to be a reconciling in Christ Church, we need to realize that working in this area doesn't mean that you're going to get a lot of applause. There won't be a lot of appreciation to put a sign outside saying that we are an RIC church. So we're not doing it for that reason. You're not going to get a lot of appreciation. This massive reservoir of courage and hope is what pushes us in this direction. Our role as ambassadors vary, and depending on how deep the resentment, depending on how systemic the injustice, depending on how hard the other party may be or how our hearts might be, it may take a little bit longer than we expect. Yet the flexibility of a minister of reconciliation could be summed up by identifying us as go-betweens. That's the term I want you to take away from this message today. We are go-betweens. We are advocates. We're supports. In 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 5 and 6, Paul says, there is only one mediator between God and humanity, Jesus, who offered himself as a ransom for all. To be in any relationship is to run the risk of misunderstanding. Any relationship. To be in any relationship is to run the risk of friction. To be in any relationship is to run the risk of hurt, sometimes desperate hurt. To be in any relationship is to run the risk of lack of know-how any relationship that we're in, or in a relationship where there's non-compliance. All of these things keep groups and keep people from healing each other. But ambassadors of reconciliation know that the relationship can endure injury, but are fragile enough to crumble unless the proper support exists. And that's what we're talking, building support to be a reconciling in Christ church. Ambassadors frequently function as those who support identifying factions. You know, you feel sometimes like you're right in the middle. Right in the middle. And they're in the middle trying to suggest ways for mutual understanding that would lead to some kind of peace. That's what a go-between is. The ambassador of reconciliation mediates for families who are not speaking. Families who are not speaking to each other. The go-between mediates for governments at war with each other. The go-between, it's an individual who mediates between the person who has hatred and resentment for each other. You don't get a lot of love being in the middle of those kind of relationships. And this usually means holding on to each party in the dispute. Agents of reconciliation. That's why the image of Jesus on the cross, it's like he's in between two worlds. Humanity and divinity. And he's holding on to both of them. Holding on to parties in dispute. While we're being what? Pulled. And tugged. And sometimes even trampled on. But these discomfort and these pains are endured, first of all, because we are aware of the role of a reconciler and what it cost. And we know what it cost because we have an example of it in Scripture in the person of Jesus Christ, the one who was trying to what? Reconcile. Didn't you read that, Lisa? Reconcile the world back to God. And what did it cost him? Jesus' life. But why do we do it? Why do we think about doing it? Because we believe in the value of peace. And reconcilers are called to be a whole bunch of things: compassionate, non-judgmental, diplomatic, all of those terms that we think of people who are trying to bring people together. We operate on the principle and the hope that some form of reconciliation is possible. We just hope that some form of reconciliation is possible. Some form of healing is possible. Some form of bridge making is possible. We operate on that hope. We know from experience that openness and compassion and fairness often shakes the gridlock that we experience. And the resentment. So I admit right now that I'm really just preaching to myself. Because we want to shake that gridlock so that relationships begin to flow again. There's so much gridlock in this world. And when values at the heart of our mission of reconciliation are in jeopardy, and they experience this gridlock that I'm talking about, it seems sometimes like the gridlock can't be shake loose. And maybe then we have to figure out a new strategy that we can use. And in that case, maybe we need to challenge the status quo and to speak good news, namely a preference for collaboration instead of competition. Maybe service over power. Maybe inclusivity rather than exclusivity. We got to find a new strategy. I was talking to the person I was talking to, and they were talking about, you know, using how negative they were speaking about black issues and say, I said, so is that working for you? I looked at him. I said, is that attitude? Is that point of view really working for you? Is it working to bring races together? Is it working for you? We got to find a new strategy because what we're doing doesn't appear to be working. And by doing that, we take responsibility. We take responsibility for our part in the struggle. I play a part. You play a part. We take a responsibility for it. In a fair world, this work would be easier. In a just world, everyone would cooperate. But we live in an imperfect world. And we as agents and ambassadors of reconciliation are really being called to do our share to balance the scale. I'm not asking you to do what I'm called to do. And I can't do what you're called to do. But all of us are called to do something. And how we do it varies, with options limited only by our imagination, really. We can encourage, we can support, we can pray, we can picket. There are a whole lot of options available to us. Sometimes we realize, though, that an irreconcilable difference occurs and a situation is probably beyond repair. That's just reality. A loved one who dies by suicide, a divorce that totally divides a family, a child or an adult who's assaulted. What do we do with those situations? I think in these and in many other cases, doors of reconciliation are slammed shut. And so what do you do then? I believe that we're still being called to the necessary work of reconciliation, for possibly it is only through the work that we can see beyond the ashes that are created in situations like that and to see the promise of a new life. And while it's true that some elements of reconciliation may never happen, other forms of reconciliation can take place. Pain, power enough to break the human heart needs healing. Needs healing. And the healing ministry is a part of the reconciliation process, yet only people who know firsthand the capacity for revenge and violence in their hearts will be trustworthy. I don't need anybody talking to me about healing who ain't never been through nothing. Those who fake purity and holiness will never measure up to the difficult assignment of motivating us to surrender our grudges, surrender our hatred, and flip it into love. It's some hard work. And so reconcilers do whatever is necessary to keep us honest. You know why? Because a good reconciler is a wounded healer. A good reconciler is a wounded healer. I'm going to stop. I read the passage last week that in Samuel, where the words were saying, I'm going to change your heart of stone into a heart of flesh and blood. Agents of reconciliation acknowledge the alienation. Here I'm going to do my alliteration thing again. Agents of reconciliation build bridges to gap the separation. Agents of reconciliation speak essential words of consolation. What are those words? You are seen. You are forgiven. You are saved. You're valued. You're wanted. You're loved. Let's pray. God, we are so honored and sometimes full of fear that you would call us into this work to be agents of reconciliation. Equip us with all that we need to do all that you are calling us to do. In Christ's name, amen.
Does anyone here have a relationship that needs to be reconciled? Me too. Came across this song this week. The words seemed very appropriate. Called the Reconciliation Song. Oh, let us be a generation of reconciliation and peace. And let us be truth in love to the lost and the least of these. Let us serve the Lord in unity so others will believe. Let us be a generation of reconciliation and peace. Oh, let us be generation of reconciliation and peace. And let us build on one foundation till the Lord comes and the wars of men shall cease. Let us share the love of Jesus without hypocrisy, let mercy and forgiveness begin with you and me. Let us be a generation of reconciliation and peace. Have we not? Reconciliation and peace. And let us pray for restoration and seek the Lord together on our knees. Let us keep our hearts from evil and cling to what is good. Let us honor one another and love the sisterhood. Let us be a generation of reconciliation and peace. Let us be a generation
of reconciliation and peace.
Thank you for your physical presence. Thank you for your support in using your gifts, and thank you for your financial support of this ministry. This is the time where if you are able and or willing to support us, there are several ways you can do that. It's on the screen here. If you're worshiping with us in person, you can put your offering in the prayer box, offering box to my left and your right. Let's pray. God, we thank you for the blessings you pour into our life, and there's no way for us to ever give back at the same level that you have blessed us. You know, just life and air to breathe and a heart that's actively pumping blood throughout our bodies and organs that work, eyes to see. And there's so many blessings, family and friends and a job and a house, so many blessings that we just thank you for them. And we thank you that you also touch our hearts that to know that we are blessed to be a blessing, whether it's in giving in the offering here or giving of our time to help our unhoused siblings or giving of our time to serve in this ministry in any way. We thank you for those opportunities. In Christ's name, amen. I just want to say a brief prayer. I don't know if someone signed up for prayers or not, but I didn't get any email that anyone signed up. So I'll just offer a prayer and then open it up for all of you here with us and those who are worshiping with us via Zoom if you have a prayer request. God, there are so many places in our world, in the church, and in our personal life that needs to be healed, needs to be reconciled. And so we pause this evening just to place those empty, hurtful places on the altar. Those places where we can't imagine forgiving. Those places where we can't imagine letting that person back into our life. Those places where we have washed our hands of individuals or groups or organizations and just say to whatever with them. We ask that you will continue to touch us in that deep place of our heart. The pain that we sometimes won't even reveal to our closest friends, our partner, or our spouse. The hurt that we go to bed with at night and we wake up with in the mornings. Those places that we struggle to love again. Touch. Heal. Reconcile. Bring peace and comfort and hope and strength. Lord, in your mercy, receive our prayers. This time we offer it up for prayers that you have here. I see Jim going to the mic. Thank you, Jim. Offer. Close with the Lord's Prayer and feel free to say it in whatever form that you're comfortable with or that you remember. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Kingdom come, on earth as it is in heaven. Trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, blessed it, broke it, Then he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup and he gave thanks and he gave it for all to drink. And he said, "This cup is the new covenant, the new agreement, the new promise between me and humanity, bridging that gap that was created by sin, bridging that gap that's created by hatred, reconciling us back to each other and to God and to this earth. Do this in remembrance of me." These are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. This is the body of Christ given for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you. For those who are worshiping with us here in person, we invite you to come to Christ's table. Christ invites all. Let's pray. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace now and forever. We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through the healing power of this gift of grace. And we pray that in your mercy you would strengthen us through this gift in faith towards you and love towards each other for the sake of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. May you practice kindness. May you let go of what you can't control. May you count your blessings. May you listen to your higher self and God. May you be a calming spirit and presence wherever you go. And may you share the love of God and the light of Christ in every situation you step into this week.
Borrow, for no one you won't let show. Just call on me, brother, when you need a hand. We all need somebody to lean on. I just might have a problem that you understand. We all need somebody to lean on. Lean on me when you're not strong, and I'll be your friend. I'll help you carry on, for it won't be long till I'm gonna need somebody to lean on. You just call on me, brother, when you need a hand. We all need somebody to lean on. I just might have a problem that you understand. We all need somebody to lean on. If there is a load you have to bear that you can't carry, I'm right up the road. I'll share your load. Just call me if you need a friend. Call me if you need a friend. Call me, oh baby, now. Call me if you ever need a friend. Call me. Call me. Call me. Call me. Call me.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord God and one another. Thank you all for coming out here this evening on this very hot day. It's very good to commune with you, to fellowship with you, to praise with you, to reconcile with you, to heal with you. So God bless you all. Amen. Praise God.